And if you're ready, say, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
Amen. I'm ready too. I need this word today. I need this word today. Yes. Now Cain said to his brother Abel, let's go out into the field. While they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is your brother Abel? Then the Lord said to Cain, where is your brother Abel? I don't know, he replied. Am I my brother's keeper? Then the Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are under a curse. Somebody say a curse.
Curse.
And driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hands. From your hands.
Yeah.
When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is more than I can bear. I'd like to speak to you today, coming from verse 12. When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth. I want to talk to you today from the subject, bloody hands. Bloody hands. Bloody hands. You may be seated in the presence of the living God. Bloody hands. When God began to speak to me about this text, it started on Wednesday night. Doing a Wednesday night, doing a series of dealing with depression. And we began to deal with certain phases of depression. And the first one was learning how to deal with disappointment. And I must admit, hey, all of us will one day or another have to deal with disappointment. Just have me preach and tell your neighbor, you're going to have to deal with some disappointments. Ooh, y'all don't do this to me today. Amen. Amen. That was the wrong neighbor. Look at somebody else and say, you will have to deal with disappointment.
You will have to deal with disappointment.
Okay. And then we learned that we have to deal with disappointment. If you don't deal with that disappointment, disappointment will grow into or mature into discouragement. And when you start dealing with discouragement, you're on your way jumping into the vehicle where you're going to let depression take over the steering wheel. Please, please, please hear me today. Don't let depression take over your vehicle. It reminded me of a story about my grandmother, the late Dethy Mitchell. She was in the first stage of Alzheimer's, and our family wasn't quite familiar with this type of disease or disorder. And she decided to go outside and cut the yard. and once she make up her mind to do something, there was no stopping Dethy Mitchell when she make up her mind to do something. Say, I mean, she was just a tough lady like that. She was just Good. Once you make up your mind, some of us are like that now. Once you make up your mind, it takes a whole lot to get you to hear and to listen when someone is trying to get you on the right path. So she didn't listen to my cousin that was only one with her at home, my cousin Stephanie. So she went out there and she let her cut the yard. She cut the yard, she finished cutting the yard. And after she finished cutting the yard, she reached down up under the lawnmower to pick it up. For whatever reason, I don't know why she decided to pick up one side of the lawnmower, and it happened. I mean, this is what we wasn't expecting. It happened. She ran in the house and she told Stephanie, she said, "Look what I've done." And Stephanie went into panic mode. See, some of us go into panic mode when we see certain people around us dealing with some issues, and we go into panic mode. And Stephanie was like, "Oh my God, she ain't no one to call 911. She forgot 911 number. She called, she couldn't think of nobody number to call." And my grandma said, look what I've done. And she raised up a bloody hand. She didn't have none of her fingers on her hands. Oh, I know this. Ooh, just make your flesh crawl. Because she didn't scream. She didn't run.
Yeah.
But she had to go in and have somebody to witness. Look what I've done.
Yeah.
And Stephanie went in the panic mode, and I don't know what made her go and put her hand in some gasoline to stop it from bleeding, but it stopped it. It stopped it. Sometimes when you get medicated by God, sometimes it will burn. I'd rather burn now than to burn later.
Amen.
And so grandmother went to the doctor and he was able to put her fingers back on and she was healed and everything was back in place like it never happened before.
Yes,
yeah. Oh, I come to talk to you today. Because some of us, we need to go to the doctor so we can be healed in certain places. And it looked like, just help me preach today, and say, "I don't look like what I've been through." If you would have seen my grandmother's hand, you would have never known that she had a hand cut off by a lawnmower.
Yeah.
And she no longer had to say, "Look what I've done," any longer, because you cannot tell what had happened. So all we have left is stories of the past.
Yes.
Can I talk to you today?
Amen.
Can I talk to you today?
Amen.
Come on, say amen.
Amen.
Can I talk to you today?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So you know, sometimes we make bad decisions.
Right, yes.
Sometimes we don't even know what decisions to make.
Right.
And because we have made bad decisions, sometimes it stops us from trying again.
Yes.
Please listen to me because I'm still in the text.
Yes.
And we must learn to live through the seasons of tough times and tough seasons.
Right.
We must learn how to deal even with not just tough seasons. We got to learn how to deal with good seasons as well.
Right.
You know what? Good seasons can really teach you a lot too, because the question is, can you maintain the momentum when you're going through a good season?
That's right.
And oftentimes, God has to shake us up and allow us to go through some tough times to let us know that we was in a good season.
That's right.
Y'all ain't gonna say nothing to me up in here. That's okay. I'm gonna preach anyway. Amen. I come with my own fuel today. And so now, so many of us feel that we are in a season of stagnation.
Right.
Some of us feel like we are in a season of condemnation. Stagnation, feel like I'm not going nowhere. Stagnation. Feel like I'm just here. I'm not accomplishing anything. I'm not fulfilling any of my goals. I'm just stagnant right now. And if you let that fester, then you will catch yourself going into this vehicle that we call depression. We find ourselves in this vehicle. Then when we leave from there, maybe yours may not be stagnation. Maybe yours may be condemnation. Maybe you're your worst enemy. The enemy's job is to make you go into condemnation. And we learn in Romans that there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. And so we have to learn how to shake off, even though, here it is, even though I did it wrong. Look what I've done, even though I've done it. You can't let the enemy keep you focused on what you have done. Look at somebody say, don't focus on it. Because people won't let you forget. People won't let you forget it when you done messed up. Oh, and if you really go back and think about it, some people only remember you behind your mess.
That's right.
Oh, y'all never talk to me? That's okay. Look here, I'm gonna talk to you today. Because see, if it ain't stagnation or condemnation, then we deal with frustration.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Sometimes I don't know which one I would rather deal with. I don't know. Sometimes I don't like frustration. I don't like it. Lord knows. I don't like to be frustrated because I feel like I can make something happen to make this thing change. But sometimes it just won't change. So what do you do when it just won't change? We want to talk about it today. Because if it just won't change, we're going to find out why this thing will not change. I'm going to give y'all two words today we're going to talk about. Two words we're going to talk about today. And I'm going to get out of the way, and I'm going to want you to go study this word for yourself. We're still in Genesis chapter 4, and we know that there was two sons. There were two sons. There were Cain and Abel. There was Cain and Abel. I'm going to give you two words today. Somebody said two words.
Two words.
Yeah. You got to say it like I said. Somebody said two words.
Two words.
Yeah, I'm going to give you two words today that we will have to learn how to handle. First word is that, the first word we're going to talk about is examine. Word number two is, what is word number two? I heard something. You ain't tell me what it is. The second word is enough, okay? First word is examine. Second word is enough. Say it with me. Examine.
Examine.
Enough.
Enough.
Examine.
Examine.
Enough. One more time. Examine.
Examine.
Enough.
Enough.
See, Cain, this God is coming at us, coming after this Cain spirit. This Cain spirit. Did you notice that it happened? And sometimes this Cain spirit will come unexpected. This Cain spirit will show up and show out, and it wasn't even planned, but it comes behind two areas of disappointment and discouragement. Now, God wants us to be encouraged, not discouraged. Amen. Can I get a witness up in here? So we know if it's discouraged, it's not from God. And anytime we allow discouragement to entertain us, we got to be careful. We got to be careful. Y'all hear what I'm saying? I didn't say you got to be careful. I said we got to be careful.
That's right.
Because this thing is real.
Yeah.
Man, this thing is real. Yeah. So we're going to talk about how many words today?
Two.
We're going to talk about two words, and that is examine and enough.
Right.
Cain and Abel was born. Cain was the first one. Abel was the second child, and they had brought an offering. There would be a season of your life where you will have to bring an offering to God. Now, I'm not just talking about finances. I'm talking about sometimes you will have to bring an offering to God. And that, this was the situation here that Abel brought an offering, and Cain brought an offering, but God did not respect Cain's offering. It messed me up because I've always wondered why he didn't take Cain's offering. But he took Abel's offering. And in studying this, I learned that Abel gave his best.
Yeah.
He didn't hold nothing back from God. He was truly grateful.
Yeah.
Man, I done ran into a lot of ungrateful people.
Yeah.
Have you ever ran into some ungrateful people?
Yeah.
I mean, just ungrateful. I don't care how much you do for them, they just ungrateful. Yeah, y'all don't hear me preach today. I don't care how much you go out of your way, you just will run. Oh, I didn't mean to call y'all boo boo. I didn't mean to call y'all boo boo. I mean, God knows your heart, sugar pie.
Yeah.
God knows your heart, brothers.
Yes, yes.
But do you know your heart? Mm. He made me do some soul searching and made me examine my heart. We get quiet. Y'all think I'm gonna tell y'all business or something? Y'all think, oh God, what do you mean later? I said, my heart. He made me examine my heart. And a lot of times, I done made some bad decisions.
Right, right.
Bad decisions. Some I don't even wanna. I don't even wanna talk about it anymore. Some of it I don't even wanna bring it up. I don't wanna see no glimpse of it. Bad decisions. So I don't want to deal with the pain and the hurt anymore. I just know. I don't want to, but I didn't know this thing really got to me. Down in my heart. So here it is, Cain and Abel were there. But God took Abel's offering, but he didn't take Cain's offering.
Yeah.
And Cain got angry. Have you ever been angry?
Yes, yes.
He got angry. And then when he got angry, he started making decisions and He started premeditating something in his heart, and he might not even know that it was in his heart.
Yeah.
Until he got into the situation. He got in the situation now, and he didn't want this, and Cain, look here, Cain brought an offering, and the Bible said, Abel brought the firstborn of his flock. You know, he had a sheep, and he brought the firstborn of his flock, and he brought not only the firstborn, but he brought the fat portions of his offering of his flock. He brought whatever was the best of God, and he took what was left. The problem is, we want God to take our leftovers.
Yeah, that's right.
Huh? Yeah. He asked us the question, why is your faith downcast? Why is your countenance down? Because see, we ain't dealt with some issues that his face is cast down. And God, when God starts asking you some questions, it's not that he don't have, he know the answer. When God asks you a question, it's not that he doesn't know the answer.
Right.
He asks you a question so you can know the answer.
Yeah.
Oh God. God never asks a question that he doesn't know the answer, because guess what? Take your neighbor and say, he is the answer.
Yeah.
He is the answer when you don't know it in this season of your life. He said, if you do what is right, will you not be accepted? God will always give us another opportunity. But the question is, we never know when our grace will run out. Look at somebody say, you never know.
You never know.
You never know. Cain broke the offering, and God did not respect his offering. He got angry, and God will teach you. God will teach you. I'm going to teach you how to respect me. Just like on Color Purple. I'm going to teach you how to respect me. I'm going to teach you how to respect me. I'm going to teach you how to respect me. I don't know what it is. But God said, I'm going to teach you how to respect me. Come on, help me preach today. God said,
I'm
going to
teach you how to respect me.
Yeah. Thank you. God said, I'm going to teach you how to respect me. He thought he got away with it. Let's find out what happened to him. He told his brother, he said, come on out here, Abel. Bro, come on out here. Come on out here to the field. See, that's why I tell people, when you haven't been delivered, you can't go back to places you used to go back to, because if you go back to it, you And while they was out there in the field, Cain attacked Abel. Mm-hmm. Cain attacked him and killed him. Mm-hmm. He killed his brother. He didn't think about what his mama was going to say. He didn't think about how bad he was going to feel. He just knew what was in his heart. Killed his brother. I don't know if he planned it or not, but he called him out there in the field. And sometimes something will rise up in you. Oh, come on. Somebody said, somebody told me, well, you should have more power than that. Yes. Somebody told me, you should do that. Yes. But when you get in a situation, you don't know what you're going to do until you get in a situation. Right. Oh, God. So that's why we got to get prayer back in the church, because we need God to do something in us. Saints, we got to get back to praying.
When God examine yourself. You got to be careful.
Yeah.
You got to be careful because these thoughts going through your mind, it will cause a lot of trouble. You got to be careful because, see, people only remember you behind your mess. You got to be careful. That's why you got to keep a good communication line with God so you will know His voice when He's speaking to you. I just want to know, do you know God's voice when He's speaking to you? Hi, what does God's voice sound like? Do you know His voice or do you hear the devil's voice? We got some more to the devil than we do God. So you got to learn how to examine yourself, because anytime God is asking you a question, He wants you to examine yourself. Come on, somebody say, examine yourself. He asks you a question for the power of life and death. Here it is. It's in the power of your tongue. He said, those who love it will eat of it. If you keep speaking hatred, you're going to eat hatred.
Victorious.
Every day. face your pain, but I refuse to be stressed another day.
Yeah, yeah.
I refuse to stress myself out about anything I cannot control. I refuse to keep letting things that I can't control control my mind. Find out why. examine me. That way, what you say about me won't hurt me. If I examine myself, that means God will talk to me. And he will heal every wound. Every wound that had pierced my heart. He will heal it, and it won't hurt me no more. You say, words don't hurt. Words do hurt. You say, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words, the devil is a lie. The enemy didn't know how to play with words. He started in the garden. He went. But I'm learning two words now. Since I had a conversation with Cain, I learned, examine, and enough. Examine, and enough. Isaiah 59:3 said, for your hands are stained with blood, your fingers with guilt, your lips have spoken falsely, and your tongues mutter wicked things. God said, I'm trying to change your conversation from muttering wicked things. I'm trying to change your lips from being speaking false things. Because sometimes it ain't about what other people say to you, it's what you say to yourself. And you gotta tell yourself who God said you are. Examine and enough. Two words, please tell me. Jesus.